Yeah, that, I mean, yeah, those are the type of master data.
No, no, leave it.
Any other definition, Preeti? Okay, if I say there is another type of data called as transaction data, then will you be able to define, give a new definition for master data? Okay. The definition of master data is these are the data that you need to carry out any transaction in SAP. Okay. What are the Hello, is it clear now? Okay, yeah. So master data is the data which you need to carry out any transaction in SAP. What are the transactions? You could say creating a sales order is a transaction, creating a delivery is a transaction, creating a billing document is a transaction. Okay, to create a sales order, what are the things you need? You need a customer master. You need a material master, you need some prices of the material, okay. And if there is anything special with the customer, for example, if you want the description to be in the sales order to be displayed as how the customer requests, okay, that is called as customer info record. Okay. So to create a very simple sales order or very basic transaction, you will be needing all these data. To put it simply, any data that is needed to create any transaction in SAP is called as master data. And there is another, I told you that there is another data called as transaction data. Transaction data is the result of any transaction. For example, this and this transaction data, they are not defined by us. Instead, they are resulted by the system, resulted by any transaction or any activities in the system. For example, when you create a sales order, it generates a sales order number, that is a transaction data. When you create a sales order, it updates the credit limit of the value or the overall value purchased by the customer, that is a transaction data. When you take goods receipt or when you take the inbound delivery, it updates your inventory. So your inventory is increased from 0 pieces to, let me say, 100 pieces or 200 pieces. This 200 is the transaction data. So in very simple, whatever that results after a transaction is done, it is called as transaction data. And whatever you need to create any transaction is called as master data. In SAP, there are four types of master data. One is customer, one is material, and third one is customer material info records, and fourth one is the condition records. Condition records are nothing but your prices, taxes, surcharges, discounts, etc. Okay. So let us start with the customer master. In real time scenario, what are all the types of customers we have? Hello? I am asking, in real time scenario, what are all the type of customer we have? Yeah. Okay. I mean, like, based on the activities of customer, for example, if you are making a sales order, okay, is it necessary that you always receive a sales order from the same customer to whom you are going to deliver the goods to? Then, good, really good example. Okay, sometimes it also happens. The daughter orders the customer, and sometimes mother orders the customer, daughter receives it, father pays it. Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's what I said. Like, okay, mother orders, daughter receives it, father pays it. Okay. So for the same customer, I mean, like, there are four types of customer. That is a very important one in SAP called as sold to party, ship to party, bill to party, and payer. Okay. So I mean, are you able to see the screen now? Okay, that's the slide. What happened? Shirisha and Abid are able to? Okay. No, but you are in the meeting. No, let's see. Okay. Okay. So the screen says, like, what are all the master data we normally have in SAP. So let us go to the customer. Okay. So the transaction code for, now let us go to the logistics. Yeah, four types. Customer material info record, and condition record. It is price, taxes, discounts, yeah, rebates, whatever it could be. I mean, examples are price, discounts, taxes, surcharges, freight, rebates. Condition record. It's not only for pricing, it is for your free goods determination, material determination, even your printing of output, no, like whether it could be email or whether it could be print or fax, that is also a condition record. Okay. So, okay, just think it. Yeah. Yeah, there are different. Yeah, yeah. Okay. So let us go to a customer master first. Okay, menu is logistics, sales and distribution, master data, business partner, customer. Let me go to a customer in the change mode. Okay. So if I go to customer in change mode, I am seeing two transactions. One is VD02 and one is XD02. Okay, what is the difference between these two? Because inside it is clearly written VD02 is for sales and distribution and XD02 is for complete. So let me go to the complete view first. T-S62A01. The customer data is divided into three parts. One is general data, second one is sales data data, third one is company code data. General data is the, as the name suggests, it is the general data, like the address, the contact person, the bank details. Then you have the marketing details, like what is the turnover of the customer, what is the Nielsen ID of the customer, then like how many people are working there. So these kind of things. Why they are grouped under general data? Because that will be relevant for everybody. All the departments who access the customer will be needing those details. So that is why they are kept it as the general data, and it is relevant for it is valid for all the organizational units. Okay. Then we have the sales area data. Sales area data is valid for sales area basically. So that is why it is coming under the sales area data. Sales area data is our domain basically, and it says like what are all the, when you make a sales order, what are the things you will enter for the customer. For example, what is the order probability, and what is the plant from where the customer is being delivered to, in which, to which group he belongs to. Group in the sense like whether he is a bulk buyer or occasional buyer or new customer, and which industry he belongs to. Then what kind of pricing procedure must be assigned to him, and whether he is relevant for billing, I mean, and whether he is relevant for taxes, whether he is relevant for rebates. And then we have the shipping data, like what is the shipping priority, delivery priority, and from which plant he has to be delivered from. And finally we have the partner functions. Okay, who is going to be the receiver of goods, receiver for this customer, who is going to be the payer for this customer, these kind of partner functionalities. So these are entered under the sales area data. The third one is called as company code data. We had seen that company code is always used for creating the balance sheet, general ledger accounts, everything. That is purely financial activity. Similarly, company code data for any customer is maintained by the finance people, and it is relevant for accounting only. So company code data is not our cup of tea basically. However, in the company code data, you can see like They have assigned the reconciliation accounts, what is your payment terms, and dunning procedures, etc. So they will be, this kind of data will be under the company code data. Okay, to sum it up, the customer, any customer data is divided into three parts. One is general, one is sales area, one is company code. And as per sales, sales and distribution perspective, we have two parts valid for us. One is the general data and another one is the sales area data. So let us go to the customer master now. Can you see, right now in the screen there is a change customer, that is general data. We are in the general data screen. Okay, first is the address. There are several types. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7. There are 7 tabs basically. So first tab gives the address. So what is the physical address? That is the street address, post box number, okay, in which transportation zone this customer belongs to. Okay. This transportation zone is very useful in determining the routes for the customer. Okay. We will see the route determination later. For that, this is one of the most important field parameter. Without this transportation zone, you cannot create any route for the customer. Then is the control data. In the control data, it is like if your customer is your vendor also. For example, like you are making two-way activities with your customer. Yes. Transportation zone is, you divide any region into multiple transportation zones, and this transportation zone is useful in determining the route for the customer. For example, if you go to sales order, you can see the route in the shipping tab of the Same set of error. Okay, I'll just wait. If you go to the shipping tab, in the item level of the sales order, I can find the system automatically has proposed the route. Okay. This route is proposed based on the transportation zone defined in the customer. If you don't have any transportation zone here in the customer master, the system won't be able to propose any routes. The use of routes is to, you can consolidate the deliveries based on certain routes. So that is the use of transportation zone. Okay. In the control data, you can see vendor. For example, this customer, Retailco Textile N. Okay. This Retailco Textile N can be my vendor also, because I sell some goods to him and I buy some goods from him. In best cases, I will be creating a vendor account for this customer. Okay. For that customer, say for Retailco Textile N. In SAP. Okay. If I have created this Etelco as a my vendor also, then I can enter the vendor number here. Okay. Then, I mean, if there are so many fields, let us see only what are things that are relevant to us. Okay. And this is the VAT number. VAT number is useful in determining the account determination. Okay. While you are posting, the system will look for the VAT numbers. Then you go to the payment transaction. Here you can enter the bank number of the customer. Okay. Which country, what is the bank key, that is IFSC code, and what is the account, who holds the account. If there is another payer than this customer, for example, A62A18 is the sold to party, and if there is anybody else paying for this customer, you can enter it here. But that function is normally carried out by the partner functions in sales area. So we don't bother about this much. Okay. Then you have the marketing data like Nielsen ID. This customer class is basically what is this customer's turnover. For example, up to 0.5 million, up to 1 million, 10 million. So these kind of slabs are there. Okay. This customer class is purely for information purpose. And we are not going to use this customer classification at any part of our sales activities. Okay. This is just to maintain the database about your customer. Okay. Then it says in which industry he belongs to. Okay. What is the overall sales or what is the employee number, this kind of activities. Okay. Then you define the unloading points. If the, when the customer is receiving the goods, where should the goods be delivered or unloaded. Okay. So in unloading point, you can still define further activities like receiving points. For example, there will be bay one, receiving point one, receiving point two, these kind of activities will be there. Okay. And what is the goods receiving hour? At what time they are receiving the goods? Okay. Then if this customer is an export customer, then what are all the, then we have to maintain the export related details like what is the country he is located in, some TDO dates, SDN dates, etc. And finally, who is the contact person for this customer? If he is an individual customer, it is fine. But if it is a company, then we will be having many people for contact. You can enter the contact people here. In fact, you not only the contact details, you can even maintain the data like birthdays, anniversaries, So this is the general data. You can see like these data can be used by anybody in your business. I mean any department, any module can use this customer data, because these are not specific to any module. So that is why it is grouped under the customer data, general data, sorry. Then we go to sales area data. In the sales area data, the values are shipped into four tabs. One is sales tab. Sales tab is relevant for creating activities in with regards to your sales order. Okay. The customer belongs to which sales district, which sales office, and which group of customers are, which group of employees are serving this customer. These data are entered in the sales district, sales office, and sales group. This customer group is different from the customer group what we saw previously. Okay. This is an industrial customer. Okay. And you can use this customer to, once again, just hold on. Shirisha, can you mute the phone? Yeah, we can hear you and we can hear the baby crying also. Just mute the chair. Yeah, I do. Do one thing, as of now just unplug that mic thing. Okay. Still you can hear me. You can mute and Skype. Skype also. Okay, now it's fine. Like, now it's on this matter. Okay. It's okay, okay. But when they will send the examination, it's fine. Okay. So this customer group, what we are seeing in the customer master, it's different from the group what we had seen in the general data. That it says like, what is the turnover of the customer and what is the industry of the customer. Okay. Here we are saying this is an industrial customer, she is a trading company, so this kind of thing. This customer group classification is very much useful in our pricing. For example, I could say tomorrow that for all the industrial customers, I am giving 2% extra discount because they will be taking large volumes for me. Okay. For new customers, I will be giving 1% additional discount because just to lure them or woo them. Okay. For loyal customers, I will give 10% because 10% discount. Because they have been with me for a very long time through all my hard times, so I want to give them a very good price. Okay. So you can do these kind of pricing activities, like defining a different price itself or defining additional discounts by using the customer groups. Okay. Then you have the ABC class. Can anybody say what is an ABC analysis? Which you must have done in engineering or during graduation. Come on, even if not in engineering, you must have, okay. Abid? No idea, okay. So, you normally classify any material or any, okay. Originally this ABC analysis came from engineering, but now it is being applied everywhere. For example, in sales perspective itself, you can define a customer into A or B or C. A class customers are those who give less number of sales orders, but large value of business. large volume of business. For example, they may give only 10 sales orders per year.
Okay.
But that accounts for, let me say, but only these customers accounts for almost 80% of your sales per year. For example, they will just give 10 sales orders, but each sales order will be around somewhere 100,000, 200,000. Okay. Just by 10 sales orders, you will cross 1 million easily. Okay. These are the A-class customers who give less sales orders, but give more volumes. And there are some customers who give so many sales orders, let me say, for every month they will be giving almost 30, 40 sales orders, but each sales order value will be lesser. So their overall business volume or overall turnover from two of them will also be less. Okay. So that is what ABC analysis. B one is, okay, medium. So they give some reasonable amount of orders, at the same time considerable amount of volume of business. Okay, so that is how it's defined to ABC. If your customer is A or B or C, you can enter it here. And this field is just a freely definable field, and it is not relevant for any other pricing activities or promotional activity. It is just for a reporting purposes. So if tomorrow, if you take a printout of who are all my A-class customers, then this customer will pop up, if provided that he is not an A-class customer. Okay. Then in this, yeah. 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 If you want to add any more field, you can take the help of your adapter, and you can add the new field in which screen you want to. For example, you might want to add in sales screen or somewhere in the billing document tab. So wherever you want to add, you can add it. Yeah. Okay. So then we say, what is the currency we are using for this customer? Then you have the order probability. This order probability also is just another field that is used for reporting purposes. Based on your past history with the customer, you can say like, okay, I had given 10 quotations, he had come back to me with 5 sales orders, which means my probability of turning a sales order to turning a quotation into sales order for this customer is 50% or 75%. Okay. So by default, SAP puts it as 100%, because whenever you make a sales order for this customer, it is considered as it is 100%. This field is also only for reporting purposes. Tomorrow you can take a report like, who are all the customers I can rely on? That is, they give me business always 100%, 75%, so those kind of things. Okay. Then you can see the item proposal. Okay, leave out SAP. When I say item proposal, what does it bring? What is the notion it brings when I say item proposal? Hello? When I say item proposal, what comes in your mind? The items they usually purchase? Okay. Okay. Okay, partially it's correct. Which means you want to limit your business only to that thing? Sirisha, you want to limit the... Which means you want to limit the business to only that article without asking the customer what else he wants. he is normally a printer buyer, okay, admitted. He is normally a printer buyer and he buys pen. It means you don't want him to buy anything else. He might even think. Okay. 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 Not necessary, not necessary. Okay, the concept is okay. The sort of understanding is correct. When the customer is purchasing anything frequently, so you need not like key in those fields automatically every time. I mean, you need not to key in those things manually every time. Instead, you can create a small document called as product proposal document and assign it to the customer. Okay, so let me say for this customer TS62A19. So let me say product proposal for and okay. This customer is buying regularly the APA01. He is normally buying 100 pieces every time. Okay. AP201 100 pieces. T-AP102 100 pieces. Okay, let me just say like based on my previous and analyzing the previous sales orders to this customer, I am finding that he is buying these things more often. Okay. So I create a product proposal document. We will see this product proposal document creation here at a later time. So today I just want to show you the example. I have created a product proposal document and I am assigning that to the customer. Okay. If you remember, the product proposal document didn't have any customer or any sales organization data, nothing. It is just a list of materials, okay, with a validity date. Okay. So I can assign that particular document to any number of customers. Okay. I am assigning this to my customer. So whenever I create a sales order for this customer, I can take from those three items. Okay, we show that. There is a button called as propose item in the corner. You just click that. To which customer we are sent to? 19. Sorry. T-S62. So I could say that the one which I linked to that, okay, it is here. I can either copy everything with quantity or without quantity or select from that list. For example, the customer is regularly buying those three items. Okay. But this time he is coming with the 101 and 102 with a different quantity. Let me say he is asking for 20 pieces there, and this time he has increased the quantity from 100 to 200. Okay. So copy material and copy quantity. Okay, fine. So I didn't enter anything here manually. If the system automatically took from the item proposal document which is assigned to the customer. So this is a functionality of item proposal. Okay. Then is the account at customer. Like how we are maintaining a number T-S62A19 for this customer, he must be maintaining some code for us in his record. Okay. If you know that, you can enter it here. Once again, it is for just a relevant purpose. It's not going to make any difference to our business. Then is the exchange rate type. Did somebody ask? We didn't hear you. Are you on speaker? Okay, can you ask? Yeah. No, I just copied that number and pasted it here, that's it. Just now I created that list, so I know that list number, so I copied and pasted it. Okay, so then we come to the exchange rate type. In our case we are dealing with the local currency, that is the company we are dealing with is the, our address company is the German based and it is using the euro. Okay. So if it is a foreign company using the other currency, what should be the exchange rate type used? Whether it must be the current exchange rate or average exchange rate or so whatever it could be. You can normally take help of the finance people while defining what should be the exchange rate used. So these are marked under the sales order tab. Okay. So these boxes are and sales order block. Okay, so you can use these things when creating your sales order. Next comes the pricing block. Pricing block is purely for your pricing functionality. Okay, so based on this only the system will calculate the prices. For example, pricing group says, let me say 03 new customers. Okay, this is also very similar to your previous one which I had said, 01 industrial customers, so this kind of thing. If you want, you can define additional discounts or additional prices for these new customers based on the pricing group. And this is an additional functionality, not a mandatory one. If you don't want to enter anything, you can just leave it. Okay. Then comes the customer pricing procedure. This is the most important field of this sales area data itself. Okay. Because this pricing procedure, customer pricing procedure, is instrumental in determining the pricing procedure for the sales order. Okay. Without a pricing procedure, you cannot create any prices for the customer. Okay. So that is why it is a mandatory field. If you don't enter it, can you see that it is marked as a mandatory one? If you don't enter that, the system won't allow you to save it. Because without this pricing procedure, you won't be able to determine any pricing procedures at the sales order level. Then is the price list. Price list is normally called, it's also called as price book functionality, which means you can create a catalog sort of, okay. Your customer says, like, I just want to know what is the price you have for me for your article, so that when I place an order, I can know like how much it's going to cost me, or if there is any scale, then I'll be able to take advantage of those scale functionality. So he is asking you a catalog of all the products with the price list. Okay. So for this, you define for industry customers, I can have this format at this rate, or for retail customers I can have this much. Okay, so this is what you have, you are defining in the pricing list. So this customer belongs to industry. So whenever I create a pricing catalog, he is supposed to have the industry catalog of prices. Then is the customer statistics group. Our SAP is all about data, databases, and everything, information, processing the data. Okay. So whatever things you do in SAP, whether it is creating any masters or carrying out any transactions, okay, it always generates some values, or it will always generate some statistics. Okay. If whether this statistic has to be posted in the system or not, that you can take a control. For example, there will be some fields which you need in the business, but you don't want to take any report based on that. And similarly, there will be some customers, okay, whose sales transactions you might want to record, or you don't want to consider them at all. Okay. So you can choose the customer as relevant for statistics. Whenever you have taken a random for statistics, the customer will, this will be updating the information systems. Based on information systems only, you will be able to create a report. Okay. So that is the sales order part. Now we come to the delivery part in the shipping tab. The delivery, first we have the delivery priority. Okay. So this delivery priority, it's useful in only one situation. Whenever you have the shortage of, whenever you have any shortage of goods for particular, any goods is in shortage, and you have so many customers asking for the same, in that cases, based on your priority only, the system will reschedule the order. Okay. So if it is an important customer or priority customer, you can mark it as 01. Normal customer or low priority, so you can mark it accordingly. Next one is your shipping conditions. What is the expected turnaround in terms of delivery? For example, whether he can take it in your normal business day or normal business business process, or he wants it immediately. Example, like as soon as possible, or express delivery, or immediate delivery. Okay, so these kind of things are maintained in the shipping conditions. And there is something called as order combination. Order combination says, if there are more than one sales order for this customer, and all those sales orders are relevant, are having the same delivery day, same ship to party, that is same receiver, and same info term, same shipping point, keeping in mind from where the delivery is starting. If there is a few parameters, and if all the parameters are similar, then the system can combine the orders into single delivery. For example, I might have created 3 sales orders, but all the 3 are due for same day delivery. All the 3 start from same shipping point, and all the 3 have the same info term. Then the system can combine 3 sales orders into single delivery. Okay. If you enable this functionality only, you will have that single delivery. Still, the system will create single one delivery for each sales order. Then we have the relevance for POD. POD means proof of delivery. Normally in SAP, what we do, once we do the PGI, then we can create the invoices. In real time, it is like once the goods reach the customer, the customer will give an acknowledgement that he has received so and so. So for that, we will be writing the invoices. But sometimes, in India, it happens most frequently. They will be sending the invoice along the goods itself. Okay. But the customer is saying, like, normally it happens fine, but sometimes your invoice quantity and the actual I receive are having some differences or discrepancies. So do one thing. Until I confirm that I have received so and so goods, don't write the sales invoice. Okay. Which means you are expecting a proof of delivery from your customer. If this customer is insisting on proof of delivery, I can mark this. Once I had marked this as relevant for POD, after doing the post goods issue, I have to carry out an extra transaction for proof of delivery. Only if I do that POD or proof of delivery, then I will be able to make invoice for that customer. For example, I mean, like, okay, I had enabled the proof of delivery, but the customer, sometimes the customer might use it as a tactic to delay things further. Okay. For example, like, until he gives the POD confirmation, you won't be able to raise invoice. But the customer might use it as to buy some extra time, saying that until he hadn't given the POD, he might use that time to mobilize money in other activities. So you can mark as a, once you mark it as relevant for POD, you can mark the POD time frame, which means if I give 3 days here, I had done the delivery today, okay, this must have reached the customer today, and if I didn't hear anything for next 3 days, then the system thinks that, okay, everything has gone fine, and it automatically releases the delivery for billing. So you can enter the number of days within which you can expect a communication from your customer. If you enter it, once the system crosses the number of days mentioned here, then it enables the delivery, then it says that this delivery can be billed now. Then comes the partial delivery. What is a partial delivery? Okay. Does this happen in real time? Does this happen in real time? Okay. Yeah, that is the one. Yeah. So that is what the partial delivery is like. If your customer wants a partial delivery, if your customer can take a partial delivery, then you can enable this in the partial delivery per item. And you can define maximum number of partial deliveries. But in SAP, you can create maximum 9 deliveries for the customer. 9 partial deliveries is the maximum. But else, if you don't want, I don't want any partial deliveries, I want the complete delivery by law, then you have to enable this button. Which means until and unless the whole quantity is confirmed, the system will not create any delivery. Then it's the tolerance. So if you are ordering 100, how much I can give in the plus or minus side? If I maintain it 10%, okay, like I can deliver, if I place the order for 100, I can deliver 90 to 110. Okay, so that is the tolerance level, minimum and over delivery. If I feel like this customer, okay, whatever he gives is fine with me, then I can mark the unlimited tolerance. Okay. Now we had delivered also, let us go to the billing. Okay. The billing document first is the subsequent invoice processing. The subsequent invoice processing is used when your customer is your vendor also. In the general data, we had entered this vendor number. If you had entered that, then you will be using this. If you choose the subsequent invoice processing, what happens is, like, you must have given some rebate to your customer. As a vendor, you are buying things from him and he will be giving some rebate to you. And if you had chosen the subsequent invoice processing, you can nullify the receivables or payables. Okay. This has to be worked in close with the finance. As of now, he is a simple customer, so I don't enable the subsequent invoice processing. He is relevant for rebate. Okay, so I had checked it. This price determination is, if he is a part of any other hierarchy, in SAP we have concept of customer hierarchy. For example, there will be a sales office or head office. Okay. Then you will be having the regional officer, and you have the end store, basically. Okay. So whenever you are entering in any agreement with the company, you normally do it at the head office level. So whatever you do at the head office level, it will automatically flow into the next subsequent hierarchy or nodes, what we call as. So for example, like if you are defining a discount for Pepsi US, that is in the headquarters, that discount will be flowing up to the even the smallest store owned by Pepsi. So if your customer is a part of that hierarchy, then you can enable this, which means so whatever price you are determining for your hierarchy, that will be applicable to this customer also. Then you have the invoicing date. I mean, your customer says like, please send me the invoices on 1st of every month or 15th of every month or 1st and 15th of every month. So on what some customers will say like, send me the invoices by 23rd or something so that I can pay it on 1st. So these kind of things will be there. Based on your customer requirement, you can assign the factory calendars to that. So whether it is a monthly or when it has to be sent, normally finance people will create the calendar and you can assign it here. Second one is the invoicing list. I mean, we have invoice dates. What is the invoicing list to date? Invoicing list is nothing but a consolidated statement for your invoices. For example, if there are 10 invoices due for 15th of August, okay, so the system will combine all these 10 into a single invoice named as invoice list, and it will be as well each item level, it will mark the invoice against the value of the invoice. My invoice list is 1. Okay. It will, in the item level, just like your sales order, it will say invoice number 1, $100,000. Invoice number 2, $75,000. Invoice number 3, $10,000. Okay. So it is a combined list of all the open invoices that are due for a particular day. If your customer wants to receive invoice list instead of invoices, then you can use the calendar functionality when to send him. Then we have the Incoterms. Incoterms says like how the goods are being priced. Incoterms is international commercial term. Okay. So it's like this customer is, whatever you quote for this customer, it is a cost freight paid price. It means you are accepting to pay the freight also. Then comes the terms of payment. Terms of payment is how this customer is being allowed to pay the money, whether it is in 90 days or 60 days. In our case, it's like 14 days. If he pays within 14 days, he will be getting 3% discount. If he pays within 30 days, he gets 2% discount. So this is the payment term. And you have the credit control area. If a customer is maintained any credit, then your finance people will give you the what is the corresponding credit control area, which you have to enter it here. Next, we have the field called as account assignment group. Account assignment group is useful in determining the ledger account, general ledger account, against which the revenue has to be posted. For example, when I sell 100,000, when the value of sales order is 100,000, it is not like 100,000 is a single entity, of which your 70,000 will be your product cost, okay, and 10% will be your discounts, taxes, then 20% will be the freight. So when the amounts are getting posted into general ledger account, it will split into 70 plus 10 plus 20, and 70 will be posted to domestic revenue, 10 to the taxes, and 20 to the freight account. So based on this account assignment group only, the system will determine the appropriate general ledger accounts. There are two places where this account determination is controlled. One is in the customer level and another one is at the material level. Tomorrow we will see the material master. The account assignment for customer is done at the billing documents tab of the sales area data. And finally, you say what is the tax liability for this customer, whether he is liable for tax or exempted from tax. And last one is the partner function. The partner function, you say like who is going to order and who is going to receive the goods and who is going to pay for that. Okay. So out of which, if you notice, only the sole to party is grayed out, which means you cannot enter or modify the sole to party. Whereas the other ones are freely, can be edited. For example, I am ordering and I receive the invoice, okay, and either I can pay or let my brother pay. So let me say S-62A20. My brother is also a payer. Okay. So in the payer level I can have two. Either I can pay or my brother can pay. Similarly, let me say either I can receive or my brother can receive S62A20. Okay. So what happens is like you can make except sole to party. For other business partner functions, you can maintain more than one functionality. Okay. One entry you can make. So, if you remember, when creating the sales order, system automatically populates the ship to party. Okay. Till now, there was only one ship to party assigned to the sole to party. So, the system took that ship to party as a default one. Now, I had added one more ship to party to the same sole to party, to the same customer. Now, if I try to create a sales order, the system will give me a choice to whom the goods has to see. Can you see? It says like there are two payers and two ship to parties defined for this customer who I want to use. Okay. Let me say, let me receive this goods and let my brother pay it. Okay. And let my brother receive the goods. So I am marking S62A20 as my alternate payer and shipper. Okay. So that. The green one is means a selection is made. If you don't make any selection, it will turn to red. Okay, so these are all the customer master field /MID02. Now we have to create. End user will give the, you have to give the template to them and we have to upload in the batches. Because at time of implementation, surely there will be some minimum 10,000 customer masters. Even if it is a small business, minimum there will be 10,000 customer masters and they cannot create it. Yeah, whenever it comes new, one or two, they can create it directly. Else, we have to give the template format to them so that they can consolidate on weekly basis and then upload. But first upload will be done by us. Yeah, some spreadsheet basically. Yeah.